thanks for having me. And hopefully next year, the next EIC user group meeting is in your country. So hopefully we'll see each other also next year. We can't wait. Most of us can't wait to go travel again. So this is a rinky-dink talk. This is the introduction. I was asked to talk a little bit about the status, the quest to understand the fundamental structure of nuclear matter and the outlook to an electron ion collider. You're going to get excellent speakers behind me. And some of the cheers, some of the cringe what I'm saying, but that's okay. My job is to pose the questions, get the excitement, and get the status of the electron ion collider. And get people hopefully to think a little bit what's different in our science now. So I'll talk a little bit about the quest to understand the fundamental structure of matter. I'll introduce nuclear ventography, go a little bit about one longitudinal dimension. I know Katarzyna is after me, so I'll take a step back. What did we learn up to now? Go over the US-based electron ion collider, give some science examples, the status, and then the summary. So that's the plan. So first of all, okay, this has been a long-standing saga. What we're trying to do, at least on my side of the fence, is to understand the fundamental structure of matter. And I'll show you here a little bit how we go more or less from matter, in this case, a droplet of water, and what we learned. And there's nice little cartoons in years, more or less, how we go down deeper, delve deeper and deeper into matter. And in the end, we do know that inside protons and neutrons, there are quarks and gluons. That's not a surprise. But we do also know that despite what our beloved Greek philosopher said, you cannot hold a quark and a gluon in your hands. So in the end, the matter is indivisible, and we're trying to learn about the structures of protons, neutrons, and nuclei in indirect means. So, and this is going to be interesting. It's going to be a wonderful world around there. So first, to take a step back, at some level, the EIC is trying to understand the dynamics of QCD. It's trying to understand what's the role of the gluons deep inside all of us. And to take one capture phrase back, if there would not be gluons, we would not be there. There would be no visible world. So gluons are not just the particles which bind. And they have a direct role in the structure and dynamics and the interaction of matter we see around us. So of course, do the quarks. But in that sense, and I'll come back to that, when we're trying to learn about the fundamental structure of the deepest level of matter, it's going to be a wonderful quantum mass world out of there, and it's all dynamics. So let's take a step back, and this is a slide I use sometimes for more channel audiences. If you stand on your bottom scale at some level, what we're trying to quantify is our mass. We also know that the standard model works pretty well, so we know that we have the subatomic particles, their constituents, their interactions. Okay, we found the Higgs, that's good. We know there are some issues with gravity, but overall, the standard model explains the fundamental structure of physical matter in terms of quarks, gluons, and interaction. That sounds good. However, it's not completely true. And I always say this a little bit, think about a QED. QED, yeah, we know the Lagrangian. We think we know everything, and see how much research is still going on there. That's where we are. Yeah? I mean, it's not just that big computers can have the Lagrangian and solve it. We need to get more or less to a real and next level of understanding inside physical matter. And as one example, the mass of the quarks is much less than the mass of the proton. Mass of the quarks, of course, partly the Higgs mechanism, is much less than the mass of the proton. Gluons are massless. How does this work? Take a little bit step. If we go down more or less in matter, it's really all quantum mechanics. A lot of it is actually covered by the uncertainty principle. It tells us we cannot measure momentum and position with absolute precision, or energy and time. And this must be a good thing. We should even get a stamp out of it. Now, there's quite some interesting consequences already directly for matter. Let me put it a little moving on again. That means if you go deep inside matter, everything is relativistic. Even in a nucleus, the typical speed, velocity of protons and neutrons inside nucleus, about a quarter of the speed of light, they can go easily up to 3/4. Quarks inside protons are at relativistic speeds. You can have pairs of virtual matter and antimatter being created, destroyed. They can borrow their mass energy by the uncertainty principle, which means that in principle, their masses can be bigger than the mass of the proton, as long as they live short. And in the end, we also have to get more or less to observables. Because we can't get these quarks and gluons in our hands in isolation, we get to learn about our existence by more or less indirect effects, such as pressure, and like the Casimir effect in the vacuum. So that's a mess. Now, the good thing is, and that's something a further lessons learned, spin is actually very important. If you even go back in history, it brings order in this mess. And even though we had a periodic table of elements already before we realized about spin, it does bring the order. And say more or less, and we look at our spectrum of hadrons. So spin is extremely important to get order in this quantum mechanical mess. So we want to learn bringing spin to the floor too. So let's go a little bit back. What are we trying to do when we go to subatomic matter? We do know that most known matter, be it water or a rare earth metal or some nanomaterial, you can typify by a localized mass and charge center in large open space, same as your cities. You have a city, you have a lot of countryside around there. Water, yeah, we know as oxygen, there's some hydrogen circling around it, like covalent bond, that's water. And so you typically can see the structures and picture them. And there are some open space, which makes it nice because that makes our visualization easier. This is not true. When we go inside protons, neutrons, and nuclei, there are no stills anymore. Yeah. So yes, we sometimes have blobs smaller. We show you cartoons of a blob of a nucleus, which has some blob of protons, neutrons in there. Yeah, that kind of works. And then we show you, you open up the structure of the proton, you find three constituent blobs in there, two ups and a down quark. Well, that we know that it has two up and a down quarks as surplus because it needs to make the quantum numbers. But that's not the structure. And in reality, when you open more or less deep inside these can of worms, the protons, neutrons, nuclei, it's all dynamics. There are no localized centers anymore. Everything is moving, everything is interacting, everything is creating, destroying. And that in the end makes that we're there. It makes the structural interactions of whatever you see around you. If I would turn off the QCD dynamics, I essentially turn off the light because there's no structure. Now we have learned through history that to make progress here, imaging is a great tool. So that's what we're going to do. And that's essentially one of the main pieces of the electron ion collider. And I go a little bit more into also why do we start learning now that this dynamics is so relevant? Because in the end, that dynamics, things like you're well aware of, the nuclear mass, the nuclear spin, the magnetic moment, emerge out of this complex system of dynamics. They're made. So what we want to do in imaging, we want to learn about the three-dimensional structure of matter. Now that has been standing on science. People have done that, and I'll show you some examples earlier. So what we want to learn about the three-dimensional structure, and you'll hear later also from Katarzyna's talk, we know quite a bit about what we call the Lonsdale momentum distributions. But we want to learn about whatever is transverse to that direction. And that shouldn't surprise you, because whenever you want to learn about the three-dimensional world, and just look at more lenses at world around this, we need to learn about orbital angular momentum. And to do that, and just look at how more or less the planets move around, more or less the sun. Orbital momentum is clearly an extremely relevant thing. But to learn about that and open up your classical textbooks, it's a cross product. It's R cross P. So you need to know something transverse. And that's essentially the holy grail towards getting to the three-dimensional structure of matter. And we need to start what we call nuclear phantography, which is this imaging of the deepest levels of structure inside us. We need to map it in terms of either transverse position, quarks, gluons, where are they? What's their momentum fraction? What is their transverse position or what's their transverse momentum? And that's not new. If you go back more or less a little bit in solids and go back more or less to what we believe we knew about solids, here's structure pictures from 1801, how we believe the structure of, say, metals and just like look like. And then you go around 1863, yeah, we knew the periodic table. So there is a categorization here. In comes a tool around 1920. So you think you know everything. Yeah, we know more or less early in the 30s, we know QED, we know the periodic table. You think you know everything. In comes a tool, X-ray diffraction, and we make huge headway in more or less trying to get more or less to understanding of matter, more or less solid states, molecular biology. Same in the universe. We knew channel 50 since 1905. We knew that. We know the standard model on some level. People, same thing. What came in was more or less large scale surface, cosmic background probes. And we now assign an era of precision observation cosmology. So it's often the tool which you need to make progress into peering inside matter to do your ventography. And that's essentially the state we are at the moment in understanding the structure of protons, neutrons, and nuclei. Yeah? Yes, we know nuclei and nucleons. Yeah? We know they're there. We can write a Lagrangian down. We can do perturbative QCD. On the other hand, we know there's non-perturbative structure. And we don't know much about that actually. So in comes, hopefully, the electron ion collider around 2030. And what we're really after is this precision structure and dynamics in QCD. That's your tool. That's your microscope. So let's take the step back. What do we know? Well, we know that elastic electron scattering determines the charge and magnetism of the nucleon. We know that the nucleus is an approximate sphere with some radius. We do know that the charge and magnetization distributions differ. That shouldn't surprise anyone. In comes relativity. We also know that a proton contains quarks as well as dynamically generated quark, anti-quark pairs and gluons. We know, and that again, you'll hear much more about in the next talk, and I'll come back to it a little bit. The quark and gluon momentum fractions in a specific frame are very well mapped out. We also know that the proton spin and mass have large contributions from the quark-gluon dynamics. And as I said earlier, in reality, the spin and mass are an emergent phenomenon. Let's take the step back. What did we learn? Well, if we start looking at a proton, not the elastic scattering, but let's assume we do deep and less scattering, we start looking at the quarks and gluons inside protons. What we're really capturing is a one-dimensional dimension. The reason for that is that the interpretation of the structure of protons, neutrons, or whatever, as we have it in quarks and gluons, our interpretation in terms of partner distribution functions, is very well defined in, say, an infinite momentum frame. Now, in that frame, you can kind of get a boost. So your length is kind of contracted. And you see that here. You can define some invariance. You can do your symmetries and define your invariance. Put your more or less unknowns in there, and there in come the partner distributions, describe the non-perturbative structure. So, but it's good because in that frame, we can understand more or less about quarks, C quarks, valence quarks, C quarks, and they can interpret these partner distribution functions as the probability to find part with a certain longitudinal momentum fraction. Okay. One analogy which you can use is it's kind of your camera. When you start looking at what we call Bjorken X, which is one of these variables, let me go back here, one of these Lorentz invariants, typically the way we describe inclusive scattering with Q squared, it's kind of the spatial resolution and X, and I'm gonna call that the shutter speed. And those are predetermined more or less by some, the center of mass energy of the tool you're using. So the shutter speed, it's kind of telling you, allowing you to peer into metal. So you have two tools. You have a spatial resolution. It's kind of your pixel size. And you can see more or less, depending on the shutter speed, you see more or less the true elementary particles. So when we talk about a proton, we often talk about constituent quarks. It's really a mix of particles together. It's an effective model. It's essentially, so effectively, the quarks conspire. They drag around each other to make the constituent quarks. And that works well because in the end, these two up and one down quarks still have to make the quantum of the proton. So think about it like that, that when you start varying more or less X, you kind of vary the shutter speed. And if you go in smaller X, you see more and more the details. If you go into higher spatial resolution, you obviously see also more and more things with smaller pixel size. So what have you learned? So here's a little bit, and I'm sure that Katarzyna will talk a lot about it in the next talk. This is kind of a summary of the one longitudinal momentum distribution, the partner distribution functions. There's G for gluons, S for quarks, C, up and down for the up and the down valence quarks. A little bit arbitrary, but we know there's a surplus in the proton of two up and one down because we need the characteristics of the proton. Note also that these guys are divided by 1 over 20, the gluons and the strange quarks. So if you would take that away, they are much and much bigger. Okay, let's turn the movie on, and I'm sure, oh, does that work? Why doesn't it work? Okay, let's do it like this. Yeah, there we go. So I'm just changing now the spatial resolution with which I look in this thing. And this movie was made by Richard Sheet and Claire Quanlan. And again, you're going to hear much more about that, what the relevance is later. This looks good, isn't it? You have all this data, small error bars. Yes, we want to know it better. But it really tells you more or less how your beam, is a beam of particles. That's what it tells you. It doesn't tell you about the Friedmann Mesmer structure. I'll come back to that later. And you also see more or less the deeper you peer in with better resolution, better pixel size, you look inside a proton, you see gluons, a wall of gluons. So, okay, let's take this step back. So we have all this data, infinitely small error bars. That's nice. But what does it teach us about the proton? Now think about it again. This is interpretable in this particular frame. And this is good, isn't it? Our energy colleagues are very interested in that because that tells them in level how their beam, their hadron beam or their nuclear beam, can be described at a set of quarks and gluons, which is what they need because they want to bounce these particles off each other in their quest for understanding. What we often want to do in nuclear particles, we want to understand the structure. We want to understand where the structure interactions come from. So though this is nice, all these nice error bars, it doesn't help us too much about the structure. And I'll show you that. Let's make a movie, another movie. I pretend I'm looking at this thing. So the higher Q squared, you get higher spatial resolution power, but also more boost. And you get this boost. And now essentially, what does the part distribution tell you? You got to fictitiously put yourself transverse to this boost and start counting the momentum fractions of the particles coming through. If you want to change that into a three-dimensional structure, you have to make some artistic rendering. And that's often what we show you. We show some quarks moving around. We see some sheet quarks appearing, disappearing. We show some gluons, which is like the grayish, milkish area. But that's an assumption. And we don't know. All we know is this momentum fraction in that particular frame. And it's complicated because in the end, you get to deal with this boost. So it's great if you want to learn about higher energy, push the high energy frontier. But it's not great if you want to learn about the three-dimensional structure of matter. Yeah, because it doesn't tell you too much. So that's what we want to do. We want to call nuclear phantography. We want truly to learn about how does this QCD dynamics makes the structure and the interactions of matter. So the unprecedented call for the 21st century is to how we're going to image this subatomic matter. And in my view, if I want to learn about the nucleus or about the visible matter, I got to know the proton, I got to know the neutron, I got to know the pion and the kaon, because they're relevant for the binding for the nuclei, and likely also the lambda, because we have neutrons. So that's what we're going to do. So it's truly a new era, what we're trying to study. How does this look like inside? And again, there's no still. It's all a mess. It's all a jungle. Yet there's order. At 12 CV, we more or less set the road to a smallest imaging where essentially these valence quarks dominate. And you see, we really want to learn about the role of the gluons and the quarks. How do we do that? And again, I'm sure you're going to hear more later about that. We go essentially beyond more or less these process we use to get these nice partner distribution functions inside the proton. We're going to use more exclusive reactions. For instance, we're going to use what's called deep exclusive scattering. It means I'm going to pull a needle out of a haystack. I'm going to look at the scattering probability where you have electrons quark scattering, but for the rest, I'm only looking at a piece where everything stays intact. Yeah? So yeah, I can find out the full final state. That gives me sensitivity, and you're going to hear, I'm sure, more about it later, about what quarks or gluons with some loose to momentum fraction, what kind of transverse location they can occupy. Or I can do semi-inclusive deep inlet scattering, where I make, say, scatter an electron, and I measure one or two or a few hadrons, and we're going to look at that transverse momentum. Well, that transverse momentum must come from whatever intrinsically the quark and gluon had inside a proton. And I'll give you an idea about what scale that is. And whatever transfer momentum is gained is scattered by the fragmentation process. But either way, I'm getting something transverse. I'm getting transverse location or a transverse momentum. In comes my tools, my processes towards true imaging, towards this three-dimensional phantography. And again, I won't go too much into that. But in the end, if you do this, and that shouldn't surprise you, if I do inclusive scattering, that's a big piece of the scattering probability. If I start getting this needle out of a haystack, I'm going to measure all the particles. Yeah. In this case, my nucleon breaks apart. In this case, semi-inclusive, I break my nucleon apart, but I still have more or less one or two hadrons, which I measure, because that helps me, because I can find out was it an up quark or a down quark or a gluon or a quark, strange quark, exclusively, I'm going to measure everything. That has a huge impact on the energies you want to measure it and the detector and interaction reach. It also, and that shouldn't surprise you, it needs more intensity because the process, this process has less probability than this process, much and much less. Okay. Tell you a little bit, okay, now we have this process, we want to look at this and we want to do this imaging. So I need some energy to unambiguously see more or less to resolve these particles. Well, we know that we need high enough energy that I can be sensitive to quarks and gluons. On the other hand, I got to resolve quantities of the quarks and gluons, this transverse momentum and the transverse spatial size of order of a few hundred MeV. That shouldn't surprise you. You can just assume that your proton is a confined state where more or less, and you can take its radius or you can take lambda QCD, and you can more or less the back of the envelope find yourself that if you do that, you'll find of order the average transverse momentum or the average transverse spatial distribution of scale 100 MeV. So if you want to measure something of scale 100 MeV, you don't want a 1 TeV beam. Typical rule of thumb, you can determine things of order 10 minus 3. So, okay, we want a proton and ion beam of order 100 GeV. That's the ESC. We need to more or less make this energy such that my microscope works as good as possible. That sets the energy scale. So there has been a long planning for the EIC more or less over time. And the community has been working on electron ion colliders since late 90s, early 2000s. It went through all kinds of series of long range planning in the United States, 2002 long range plan, 2007, 2015 long range plan. There was independently National Academy of Sciences. And in the end, everybody concurred and EIC is maybe something you should think. And here gives you some findings developed by this National Academy of Science committee. The finding one, and EIC can uniquely address three profound questions about nucleons, neutrons and protons, and how they are assembled to form the nuclear atoms. How does the mass arise? How does the spin arise? And what are the emergent properties of dense systems of gluons? And you're going to hear more about some of these things later in your summer school. They also find that you can answer that by an electron ion collider with you, what you need. You need highly polarized beams. You need electrons, you need ions, protons all the way to nuclei. You need intensity because you're trying to find this needle in the haystack scattering probabilities. And you need to be able to vary your energy. But you don't want infinite energy. Yeah, so it's a very versatile microscope to be able to do your phantography and learn about these questions. And then they have some more text and they directly tell you already, and this shouldn't surprise anyone, all these numbers, more of what center of mass energy you need, 20 to about 140. You need ions all the way to the heaviest stable nuclei. You need an intensity of order 100 to 1,000 times higher than more or less what the only previous electron proton collider we ever had in the world was. And again, and that is again to go to this phantography or three-dimensional imaging of the gluon and quarks. And we need spin. And I told you earlier, spin, that makes order. Yeah, so we do need to know more or less also, we need to have polarized beams of electrons and polarized beam of protons and light ions. Now, beyond this, there were actually two more relevant things for this National Academy of Science Committee, why an ESC went so well. And I'll show you that a little bit. One is the accelerator science technology. Colliders are good. Accelerator beams are good. There is more and more importance of accelerators worldwide. And okay, many of us know about medical Linux. Any modern hospital nowadays has some Linux, which makes your radiopharmaceuticals in the background, in the basement. There's of course proton radiation therapy. But look at this, the biggest piece is actually industrial accelerators. And they're used for all kinds of things. They make your clothes feel better. They make for shrink wrap. So there's much and much they're making for your ICs. There's much and much more use of accelerators for the next level of applications and manufacturing. Of course, we want to learn about accelerator science technology. And an EIC is a dream because you get more or less variable energies. You get more or less polarization. You want to have high intensity. So all the tools you can ever think about are in there. Second piece, there's worldwide interest. Think about the US. They saw more or less at that time, they were talking about the National Academy of Science. There were about 800 people interested in the EIC. Yeah. $0 spent on it yet, and people are all interested worldwide working on it. That's the map where people come from. By now, it's 1,300, and you see the growth a little bit, isn't it? This thing is not stopping. People start seeing that this is an extremely relevant science question. Yeah, if we want to learn about more or less where the structure and interaction of our universe come from, the visible universe, we need to learn about the role of these dynamics inside protons, inside neutrons, inside ions, inside nuclei. You see a little bit that's worldwide. It's not just US. I mean, you can see more or less there's a large contribution from Europe, including Poland. There's a large contribution from Asia. We have some of the other continents in there, and of course, North America also. There's an annual ESU group meeting, which also goes around the world. I'll show you a little bit where we have been. Next year, hopefully, we'll all meet in Warsaw, Poland, for the next set of the EIC user group meeting. And it's going to be very exciting times, and I'll come back to that later, where we are with the electron ion collider. So to take a step back again, we kind of know that massless gluons and almost massless quarks, through their interactions, through their dynamics, generate most of the mass of the nucleons. We know gluons carry about 50% of proton momentum. Yeah? We know they're essential for the dynamics of confinement. We still don't understand confinement. We know that the properties of hadrons are intrinsically tied to the properties of the vacuum. And here's the vacuum. The key vacuum QD is not empty. There's a lot of jungle going on there. And we also know that in the end, we have a nuclear force. Well, that must come from a leftover of the quark-gluon interactions. Because in the end, it's QCD, which determines also the structure of the nuclei. Yeah, of course, we have an effective model in terms of protons and neutrons, but where the force came from, it must come from the Lagrangian. How this happens, we don't know. So if I speculate, if I do my little standing back, where do we need to go? We need to get to an understanding of the internal structure of protons and more complex nuclei. That's comparable to what we know now about electronic structure of atoms. That's the heart of modern technologies. Well, we need to go levels deeper. And we can, we now start already knowing, just because it's a quantum mechanical world doesn't mean we cannot use it. Yeah, look at quantum computing. So this is where you need to go if you really want to make more or less any modern, more or less country should be interested in nuclear physics, because that's in the end where your applications come from. Okay, where is the EIC from? The EIC, what we want to do, we want to have a microscope to a broader region from where a proton is mostly two up and a down, with a lot of gluons still, to a region where it's all gluons. And here I took this vector of 1 over 20 away, and you see at Q-stress 10, if you look deep inside matter, you see a wall of gluons. We also want to have heavy nuclei because they're critical to explore high density gluon matter. That shouldn't surprise you here. Look at this. These gluons rise out of the sky. So, yes, there will be dense gluon matter in all of us. So the ESE will essentially explore that landscape over a range of resolution, Q squared, and a range of quark-gluon density in the region, which is relevant for this non-perturbative three-dimensional structure of matter. That's where we need to be with the ESE. And to give you a few flavors, can it do it? I'm not going to go in details about some of the science. I'm sure you have many more talks about that. I just get you the scenery, the main thing. An ESE can give you, in the end, if we project more or less, the transfer spatial distribution of gluons. To take a step back, we do not know whether the gluon distribution is the same as the charge distribution, the magnetization distribution, the mass distribution. We do not know it. Yeah. So yes, we know about momentum distribution, but it doesn't tell me anything how they're spatially distributed. We need to know it. We need to know if it's different in the nucleus, and I'll come back to that later. Is the division smooth? Now, I'm not going to go in detail, but the fact that you see fine error bars and you see some more or less uncertainties, small uncertainty, you see some scope here, tells you you can, in the end, make these spatial images of gluons as a function of Birkenex. And the reason why you do it as Birkenex, because the scenery, the landscape, again, in a proton, in a neutron, in whatever, changes. It goes from a few quarks to a region where a lot of quarks comes in, gluons come in, to a wall of gluons. So you want to see more or less how that affects your structure. We can look at transfer momentum distributions. Now you can say, well, if I do the transfer spatial, why do I do transfer momentum? It's the same R cross P. No, well, it's not. That is one of the virtues of QCD. And the reason why this is kind of a density model as a transfer momentum distribution, and you see it's offset, it's not symmetric anymore. The reason it's not symmetric, because your spin selected a preferential state of direction. So that's why you get the up quarks moving in one direction and the down in the other. That's essentially at a higher level of spin orbit force, which is doing that. Now, why would you do this? And this is kind of the interesting thing. The transfer momentum distributions go to the root of QCD, of our understanding there. And let me sidetrack and I'll make it applicable for Poland. Let me try to do this right. Let me think about, I'm in Krakow, and you guys decide more or less, okay, the flag of Poland should be this color of red and this color of white. That's the color we all agree on. The problem is you want to bring your flags to your ships in Gdansk. Okay, one group happily takes their flag with a nice little Polish flag, and they decide, I'm going to take, where do I go? I go to, what the hell is it? Poznan. I go to that area. And the other people say, no, I go to Warsaw. There's my capital. I go that way. They arrive more or less in Gdansk, and the colors of red will be different. And that has to do more or less that in QC it matters more or less. You can get sensitive to quantum phases. That's not a surprise. The Berry phase showed us phases can have impact on your observables. So you start picking up exactly the color interactions when you start looking at these transverse momentum distributions. All right, off my soapbox. Mass, yeah, what do we know? We know the visible world is mainly made of light quarks. Its mass comes from quark-gluon interactions. We know the protons about 1 CeV. We know it's gluons when we look deep inside. That's what the hero discovered. We know that most of the mass is generated by dynamics. We know that pion is only 100 MeV, roughly, much less. Mm-hmm. It only exists if mass is dynamically generated. Let me check how far in. Okay. We don't know whether it's how many gluons are in the pion. Yeah. Of course, there are gluons, there are quarks, there are momentum distributions, the pion, the gain on the proton. There's a trace anomaly. There's all these things because QCD, these terms are universal. They are there. Yeah. In the end, we still end up with a pion, which is almost zero mass, a proton with 1 CeV, and a gain is half in the middle because Higgs method mass comes in. We need to know what are the different distributions. For the proton, the EIC will get an important term, contribute to the proton mass, and I'm sure that Changdong will tell you more about that, the so-called QCD trace anomaly. For the pion and kaon, you actually use the chiral features to learn about how does more or less these dynamics come to the pion and kaon structure, and what are the quark and gluon contributions, for instance. Now, I'm not going to go in details, but to show you a little bit, with an EIC, you can also start learning about the gluon and the C and the valence contribution in the pion or in the kaon. And this reduction shows you that we don't know much at the moment, but the EIC can make a huge reduction. That's from 1 to here. That's the reduction in more or less your uncertainty. Same with the form factor. EIC can really deliver on measuring the pion and possibly also the kaon form factor. There are articles here. But again, an EIC likely can give you ingredients about gluon tomography, about the trace anomaly, about what happens in pions, kaons. Because in the end, whenever we talk about mass sum rules, we have to be able to understand the mass of the proton, the mass of the pion, the mass of the kaon. Otherwise, we don't understand it. Spin. Won't tell you too much about it, but in the end, let me just concentrate on this thingy. An EIC is polarized. This is kind of the state of knowledge about spin, more or less what is orbital momentum. And again, spin, the spin, proton spin half must be a piece of quarks, a piece of gluons, and a piece of orbital angular momentum. We don't know this piece, so we want to measure it. In the end, I don't want to say too much about it. I'm sure you're going to hear more. This little blue error is in the end how well we will know it after the ESC is done, or at least halfway. So we will know what the contributions are indirectly of gluons or quarks and orbital angular momentum to this proton spin. Nucleus, and again, you're going to hear much more about that. We have these nice cartoons. This used to be these balls of blue and yellow, or light gray and dark gray, what the nucleus is, some protons and neutrons. Well, the same way we learned that the proton has a lot of dynamics, so the nucleus. Inside the nucleus, in reality, you will have Mason exchange. You will have short range correlations. You might have exotic gluon exchange. It's not just a static ball. There's a lot of things happening inside the nucleus. You can have saturation. Protons and neutrons might lose their identity and overlap. So the question from the EIC, how does a dense nuclear environment affect the quarks and gluons, their correlation and interactions? What happens when in the end, when these protons and neutrons start overlapping? What happens to the gluon density in the nuclei? There's a saturated high energy. In the end, you can't stuff more and more particles in one unit box. And we do know that QCD tells you there's also gluon recommendation. And that's as next to gluon emission. So if you have more and more gluons, that must come in. So what does an ESC do? And I'll show you a little bit. I show you a little bit the cartoon here, depending on whether your nucleus is a set of independent protons and neutrons, or in the end, you get full saturation where you lose the identity of protons and neutrons. it affects the ratio of the nuclear proton distributions. And that's kind of this line moving up and down. And we can measure that. Well, can we measure that? Yes, we can, because here's the projection for years. So it does tell you a little bit what more or less the effects are going on in quarks and gluons inside the nucleus. You can do diffraction. One other finding of Hera was you more or less come in with a 7 TeV equivalent electron that bombards the proton. You think the proton completely gets ripped apart. In 10 to 50% of the cases, the protons stay together. That's called a diffractive event. You just tickle the proton, likely with a two-gluon exchange. You can do the same in nuclear. We've never done that. I'm sure you're going to hear more about that later in Paul's talk about this piece of science. And to come back to it, that kind of pattern changes more or less depending on whether your nucleus is a set of protons and neutrons or starts more or less the identity of protons and neutrons start, the protons and neutrons start losing their identity and you start ending up with one saturation scale. So one nucleus is just a bunch of gluons. So where are we, the EIC? Let me finalize the last pieces on the status of the EIC. This gives you a lot of mumbo jumbo, but in the end, the EIC went through the rhythm. That means that in the end, there was critical decision zero approved, end of December. There was a site selection. What these things mean is in the next slide, bear with me, or the slide, two slides from now. And we recently got CD1 approval, June 29, 2021. Which means we start in motion, we start doing engineering design, and I'll show you a bit later on that. This is a global picture. Around early 2023, we have what's called a CD2/VA review. Bear with me. That's when your R&D is more or less done. You see the engineering design starting, that's after CD1. Why is CD2/VA relevant? You can start doing the early construction. So we expect the early construction of the ESE to start. What is that? 1.5 years from now, 2 years from now. And you also see that the EIC operations are about a decade away. This thing just takes 10 years to build. It's just what it is. It shouldn't surprise people. It takes easily 5-6 years to make any superconductor magnet. This is just a cheat sheet for what people know, what CD0, CD2, CD1 all means. I won't go too much into it. It's the way the US works. It's a project, it's like building a house. You decide you want a house. That's your mission need. Now you're going to talk to some people, okay, what kind of houses can I think about? Five bedrooms, one bedroom, what's my range more or less? And in the end you say, okay, I want this. That's my performance baseline. I want 3 bedrooms, I want 2 bathrooms. I want so much space, I want that yard. And then you start more like getting your architect in there to start construction. That's just what an EIC project is. And in the end, CD4 is you are complete. It's a bit weird, but people get used to it. What's the EIC? It uses the Rick ring with a blue and yellow. We're not going to use both of those rings. We only use one, the yellow. We're going to add the sensor in the electron storage ring. There, in it comes. We add an electron injector. There it is, this red line. And it has first goes to the red. And then later, happily, it moves into this bluish thingy, which is in down here. Yeah, so there we go. Now we have collisions of this light blue thingy and this yellow thingy. And that's my electron line. You directly see already that this beam goes in and out or out and in. So the way more or less these interactions go are different depending on whether we take this location or this location, if it's the 2 fiber locations where a detector can be. What are the specifics? Well, this is per definition because that's what an EIC was approved for. So here are what we are supposed to deliver in the end as ultimate for parameters of the EIC, an energy range, an intensity, beam polarizations, all the kind of nuclei and 2 interaction regions. The one interesting thing is the energies are different. Electron beam is 5 to 80. Proton beam is 41 or 100 to 275. That has to do with all kinds of accelerator issues. But it's so directly interesting. It's kind of a mix of a collider detector and a fixed target detector. Because in reality, we have electrons which go in one direction and the proton nuclei in the other one. So it's not a true collider detector, even though it's a real collider detector. And I'll show you that a little bit here. EIC physics is weird. It goes everywhere. Whether you're interested in inclusive structure functions, in phantography, in pion cairn structure, in diffraction, or in spectroscopy, your science ends up differently. So you need detectors here, you need detectors here, you need detectors here, you need detectors here, you need it everywhere. I'll show you a little bit how this the typical collider detector looks like and what the implications are. And you see a little bit here, yeah, that matters. That means also there's an increased amount of detector technology in the EIC. So it's a highly integrated system. Oh, give me a second. Yeah, good. Oh, good. It's a highly integrated detector system. Here's your central detector. There's far vector detectors, far forward. And that is because we want to have it fully hermetic. One lesson learned from Hera, which I'm sure you're going back to, is make sure that you don't have a gap in Q squared. One other lesson is you detect some of your particles will decay. Well, you got to measure them. Some particles will go forward. The fraction is all the way going forward. You need all these detectors. And you need to fold in also because beam energies are different. So it's a 2-to-4 integration. And arguably, this is going to be the most difficult to integrate detector ever. Give you an example. I won't go into detail. This is one example based on a new free tackler magnet that's assumed by one. And you see that actually this detector looks a bit weird. It's grayish. I start filling in the colors. It has tracking. It has particle ID, green colorimetry, and hadron colorimetry all around. You need the tracking. Here's the interaction point. You see the green surrounding everything. You see the red surrounding everything in the blue. So you nearly need all kinds of detectors always around your interaction region. But you also see the difference. These detectors here, just visually already, look different than here. That's because most of the electrons go here, and it's a microscope. You cannot afford not to measure electron. On the other end, most of the particles related to the proton ions go here, and you need to know what kind they are. Are they pions, are they kaons, are they protons, or whatever they are. How are the jets? This guy is thicker than this guy, because all of the jets, high energy jets, will go here. It's only medium energy jets will go here, and hardly anything will go here. So it's a weirdo beast. And I'm not going to bore you here, but I'll just show you some examples that we are in the engineering and design phase, and we actually have a huge head start because we have a lot of friends around the world helping us in the design of the backward electron colorimetry, the barrel electron colorimetry, the tracker, everywhere. And I'm not, or the Dirk particle ID detectors, ring detector, imaging detectors all around the world. Last thing, the user group. There was a yellow report activity. It has or it was published. I'll show you a little bit. It started a year-long exercise. Many people also from Poland engaged in it. It was completed. It was posted. It is really what we use for the detector requirements and the design, as driven by the EC Science program, or the many citations. And it appeared early March. We now are starting to call for collaboration proposals, and that you show here. That's the next due date, December 1. And then we'll make a decision on priority detector, and hopefully we have enough guidance that we have a path forward to a second detector. Here is a snapshot of the proto collaborations. There are three of them, and they're in order in which they got formed, I think. Etche, about 80 collaborations, and probably 90 collaborating institutions now. Free contacts, many countries around the world involved. Athena, you'll find, where are they? Poland, there you are. About 100 collaborating institutions based on a new magnet, and Core, which is a smaller scale, a compact size new magnet, and they're aiming only at the second interaction. So what's the summary? Yeah. EIC, and I hope to show you, and I'm sure you're going to hear more from my colleagues later on. We're really in an era of more or less new understanding of QCD and what its impact is on nuclear structure. It's all dynamics. Yeah. So the aim of EIC to revolutionize this QCD understanding of nuclear and nuclear structure, where what's meant is the three-dimensional structure and how does the dynamics lead to the structure interactions of the visible matter around us. The EIC will enable nuclear ventography at the nuclear and nucleus at the scale of C quarks and gluons, where JLab, of course, we're working on more or less setting the foundation, the scale of valence quarks. Many of us believe that working together with QCD phenomenology, lattice QCD, and they all have their role, will lead to a transformation of nuclear science and hadron structure in particular. It is what we need for the next era of understanding. If you go back all the way to the Greek philosophers, we have to understand structure interactions at the finest level. I think there's worldwide interest, and we are in motion. Engineering design has started, and hopefully 1.5 years from now, the construction phase starts. So I think the way we're looking at it, to really understand nuclear science, the structure of protons, nuclei, pions, kaons, neutron stars around us, it needs an electron ion collider. Thank you.
Thank you.
I took too long.
Great. Thank you for this overview of the 21st, I will say 21st century Fox devoted to proton and its structure. I see already hands rising. Caroline, please go on. No. Are there any
questions? I was just clapping.
Oh, it is. Sorry.
I hope I set you up.
Are there any questions or comments? Actually, I have one comment.
May I? Okay.
In fact, in 96, it was when the people considered electron machine added to RIC, when there was a big workshop devoted to future Hera physics and upgrade of Hera. Also, Brookhaven started to think about adding a lepton ring to RIC and calling it IRIC. Okay, there, Michal.
Yeah, 97, the first workshop was at CSI actually, in Europe, indeed, based on Hera. And then 99 was the first one at Brookhaven and 2000 at MIT. So then they all came together.
We have two hands.
Excuse me, you have a comment or question at the chat.
Oh, I can't see that.
If we run LHC with much less energy, can we understand proton structure?
No, you cannot. It's extremely important that you need these electrons. It's an electron microscope. The electron scattering has given us all the charge magnetization distribution. Has given us more or less the charge distribution in heavy nuclei. So in the end, it's the electron microscope which is relevant because we understand QED. Of course, you can more or less try to get things out of LHC at low energies. And pieces you can get out of ultra-peripheral reactions, LHC. So I'm not saying that you cannot learn about, of course, QCD structure of the proton and the neutron. But you cannot do the full era of nuclear ventography. And the other thing which is unlikely at the LHC, I hoped I had made the argument that to make any progress there, you need polarization. You need polarized beams. You need the right energies. Yes, you get information. Of course, you get valuable information. But if you truly are interested in structure at certain dimensions, make the tool to study it.
Yeah, it's easier to use a needle than a brick to investigate the structure. Jay.
Well, this is Jay from Temple. First of all, great talk today. My question was, I think you talked about it during your presentation, but how exactly EIC can be used to probe the mass of the proton?
There's no unique recipe, but there's many thoughts about it. And you're going to hear a talk later, I think, about this by Xiangdong Qi. Essentially, if I'm paraphrasing it, but again, remember, I'm an experimentalist. I'm sure he's going to fill you in more. You can make mass sum rule, say, of the proton, and we have learned pieces of the mass sum rule through history by different observables. The one piece we don't know about is about the operator, which is also corresponding to the trace anomaly in the proton. So that's one piece where people try to get insight about what is the contribution of that anomaly to the proton mass. We also try to learn about, and we know that mass can be emergent if you start more or less looking at the chiral features. In the end, you end up with a pion mass of 100 MeV. Whatever mass sum rule you come up with, you have to explain that too. So we do believe that the chiral feature means that there are cancellations between different contributions inside a hadron structure, which means that these masses are different of the pion and the kaon. So we can measure that. We can measure the form factors, the impact of these mechanisms on the structure observables. And I personally think also the gluon tomography itself, if you start learning about the radius, gives you insight. But I think you're going to have much and much more about that in Xiangdong Qi's talk. I assume.
Awesome, thank you.
Yeah, so I think it's partly a piece of learning about operators in QCD, a piece of gaining insight. That's how I would say it.
Thanks.
Michal?
Okay, I have just two questions. One is, when I correctly looked at your, just correct me if I'm correct, I looked at this layout of EIC. It's only two detectors, or because there was one more intersection point. So how many at the end you plan to have?
Yeah, no, let me get back to that. This is a relevant question. So yeah, what people are used to, that there used to be also interaction points here and here, IP12 and IP2. In reality, if you see it a little bit here, this guy, this electron injector, which has to go in, so here's electron, they go in here. This guy here. So in the end, you also need polarimetry. You need also to be able to move these beams in and out. You can see here that the way the electrons work, and there's a long story, it has to be making it compatible with polarized beam, polarization. They go in this red ring, and then later on, they transfer into this light blue ring. That has to happen here. So the other thing is these two interaction regions you're used to from old times actually have less floor space. So there's many things more or less why they are taken away. You would need to build a whole new hall, and you need space for polarimetry. It doesn't help you to more or less do polarized beam if you don't know the polarization. So in reality, you only are left with this guy and this guy as a true large scale EIC detector. This is the one we envision to be the first EIC detector. And this is the one we want to have also. So those, it's called IP6 and IP8. But you might have been used to also that there were detectors here and here, and that's really taken away. There is so many accelerator elements needed to make sure you can get polarized proton beam, polarized electron beam. You make sure that you can cover these energy ranges. Because again, a proton is not fully relativistic yet. Electron is. So you need to have them in phase. So that's the reason. So two locations,
okay.
Two detectors, and you can offer, and you can, I think, never have more.
Thank you.
Barbara?
Hello, this is Barbara Badelek from Warsaw. A short comment to your very decisive statement that LHC won't help. Well, it will, hopefully it will help a lot. It will have polarization, as you know. And then there is even a well-advanced proposal called LHC spin. So hopefully it will go in this direction too.
Yeah, thank you. You are correct, Barbara. I was thinking the question was for the collage. You're correct. There are pieces, of course, we need.
Definitely.
LHC, of course.
And even neutrinos may help. Yeah. Even neutrinos at the South Pole help at very low X, yes.
Yes, but not for the three-dimensional structure.
Absolutely. And not... Absolutely, I agree. But LHC will help a lot, even in three dimensions.
Yeah.
Because it will measure TMDs and the like. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Now we have last question, Katarzyna.
Oh, hello, Rolf, you advertised my talk so much, so I decided I need to ask you a question.
Ah, good.
So we can stay on this slide. So you mentioned it many times, it's also written here, that you will collide electrons. How about positrons?
Yeah, now that would be a future upgrade. That is not clear yet how to do that. And we're working on that, making more or less also the reason for that, it's different than at Hera, as you're used to. So we need to really inject polarized positrons to make good polarized positron beam. So people are working more on developing that, but that's really would be a future upgrade. Same with polarized neutrons. Polarized neutrons and polarized positrons are very much the two things people would like to see in the future. But you cannot do it directly based on the energies and the intensities we need for the ESA. So it's a bit, in that sense, a bit different than Hera. Yeah, you understand, okay, isn't it? We need that intensity, so we need a very bright positron source, and we want to get the polarization. So it is a bit of development still.
Also, the present topology of the beam pipes is not favoring positrons. Mm-hmm. Okay. Rolf, thanks a lot once more. Great talk.